we have 5 viewers. Hi, everyone. We're just going to wait a little bit to let some more people come first, and then we'll start. Thank you for being here.
Hi, everybody. Looking forward to chatting. So how was your day?
It was good. I mean, working from home. How about you?
Yeah, good. I actually got to work from home today, too, with out homeschooling. So that was kind of nice to get a few things done.
That's good. Did you do it over Zoom as well, or?
No, mostly just catching up with all the emails and kind of businessy stuff. Not much chatting with people, but yeah, it was good.
That's good.
All right. Hi, everybody. Should I just go for it?
Just go for it. You have 2 hello comments.
So. Okay, great. So hi, everybody. The format tonight, I'm so happy that you're here, is we are going to talk for about 10 minutes on each age group, starting with kind of the kinders, well, 3-year-olds all the way up to kind of like 6. And then we're going to go for the school age kids. And then after that, we're going to talk about teenagers. So welcome and thank you for being here. Thank you so much for setting this up. Ariane, it's so nice that we get to do this, and we're just going to go for it. So I have a document that's coming, that's going to be posted on Facebook. It's kind of, I've created it like an email, but it's going to be coming to you, and it's got a whole bunch of great resources. So don't worry too much about spending time writing stuff down. Just kind of be present and ask some questions as they come. I'm going to be answering questions after I do those 10, 10, and 10 minutes. So, okay, so let's get started. I have a handy document here called the BC Sexual Health Learning Standards. And I think it's super important for parents to have an idea. So first of all, let me just say that I'm a teacher and a certified sexual health educator. For anybody that doesn't know, I work in the Lower Mainland and all around as far as Surrey and Chilliwack, on the Sunshine Coast. I do a lot of work at alternative schools like Vancouver Waldorf. I've gone to Bowen Island. So I really love this work, and I feel really passionate about supporting families to raise their kids with their values in place, and building safety and foundation to talk about sexuality and health and bodies. So it's not really a surprise that I'll and myself have partnered to do some really exciting things, which we will talk about later. So in the meantime, let's get started with these kindies, the age 3, 4, 5, 6. These guys are really funny. As you know, if you're a parent, do leave a comment below, because you will know what I'm talking about. They are very curious about their bodies. A lot of the time they'll be, you know, touching their own genitals. Sometimes they'll be touching their genitals when you least are happy about it. For example, when, well, grandma's not coming over these days, but I want you to know that's super normal. That's developmentally exactly on point. Kids at this age just need reminders of where it is okay to touch their body, as in what space in the home. So a lot of the time we'll talk about how it's important just to be in your bedroom or in the bath. Of course, when they're really little, we're not going to leave them in the bath by themselves. So we'll have the door open, but we're introducing this idea of privacy and private activities and private places. Also, just to do a little shout out to anybody there with somebody, a child on the spectrum or any kids with developmental delays. Those kids are my favorite. I love working with kids with developmental delays. I love the families. So I want you to know that introducing this idea of privacy is especially important for kids that that really need concrete lessons and concise lessons. So when it comes to the curriculum, what we cover at school, one of the main things is talking about body parts, talking about the names of the body parts, talking about appropriate and inappropriate touch. But you know what? I would say throw that out. Those things are important, but start with the wonderment of the body. The body is incredible. It has so many incredible systems. We have our blood system. We have, right now relevant, is our immune system. We have our respiratory system. We have our digestive system. Of course, kids that age are super excited to learn about urine and poo, because they are literally just mastering potty training, right? They kind of feel like, yes, I got it. And if they're not there yet, they're going to get there soon. Don't worry, parents. So I would say one of the things I really like to do is I like to build that excitement about the body and create a space to talk about the body in a really normal and healthy way. Similar to how you talk about, oh, we got to go have outside time. Oh, we're going to get off screens. Oh, let's read a book. Oh, look at what we're having for dinner. Remember, we got to eat our vegetables. It's the same kind of conversation. I would practice using the proper names for the body parts when you're in the, when the kids are in the bath, having a shower, saying vulva. I do teach clitoris. I think it's really important for kids to know the name, the full names of their body parts. I actually had a young boy disclose to me sexual abuse because I labeled and explained all of the female body parts, all of the male body parts, or I should say all of the vulva parts, all of the genital parts of the penis and testicles. And it was also a disclosure of a mom, inflicting abuse, which is a really horrible thing to receive. But the reason we teach about abuse prevention and the reason we use the real words, clitoris, vulva, urethra, anus, vagina, we use those words. So we're actually teaching that part of the body. Those parts of the body have names. And if kids don't know the names, they learn a nickname and we're not giving them the tools to be able to speak in a knowledgeable way so that other people can understand what they're talking about. So not the most fun or, it's a sad story, but that really drove it home to me how important it is for kids to know the names of their body parts. And if they can learn them from their parents, even better, or caregivers. How am I doing for time? I'm trying to keep it to 10 minutes.
You're good. You have 3 more.
Yay. Okay. Another thing that I really love to do here is there's a big part in the curriculum about factors that influence self-identity. So at this point, when kids are really little, for example, in my home, I have a son who loves to dance. I have a son who has been playing with my makeup. In a lot of homes in the past, he might have been scolded for that. What are you doing? I try to respond with any kind of like gender expression with the same kind of excitement you might when you see like them work really hard. If a kid is coming to you and showing them something that they're doing, it doesn't matter what their gender is. It matters how they're showing. So trying to mirror what they're showing us. If they're really excited about something, it's wonderful to kind of be excited back. So for example, both of my sons, I saw them have a really compassionate and loving response to this book, which is called 10,000 Dresses. A lot of kids have seen this book, and I know that it's in a lot of schools. And it talks about a boy who really loves dresses and has all these incredible dreams to make dresses, and then discovers that he wants to be identified as she. And it creates this kind of opening to a conversation that we may not have had before. And it just normalizes something like, oh yeah, there's some kids that are trans, no big deal. Another awesome book is What Makes a Baby. A lot of the time we get nervous to have the conversation about how does the sperm and the egg meet up? This is one way to answer the question. And it's a really beautiful way. It talks about how the egg and the sperm both have a history. They have this kind of like deep, rich history, which is the DNA that comes together. So you're off the hook, perhaps, if you're two mums, or if you're two folks with uteruses, you might not have to tell the penis and the vagina story. You can get away with just saying the sperm and the egg. But I would suggest that all kids need to know traditional ways that the sperm and egg came together, and then kind of newer technology. I think we have to move on. Yeah. Okay. So that's the littles, just building that really meaningful foundation for them. Then we go to kind of grade threes are actually grouped into that naming the body parts, talking about factors and influences of self-identity, appropriate and inappropriate touching. I want you to know that the appropriate and inappropriate touching is the most challenging conversation, I think, to be having with kids. So if you do need support with that, I do family sessions. I would also be super open to doing like a group Zoom chat with a bunch of parents to just work around that language while you're at home. What an incredible message to give is what is healthy touch, what's in it, what's unhealthy touch, or what we would call unwanted or confusing touch. So I'm going to talk about grade threes, because grade kindergarten, grade one, grade two, there's a big leap when kids are in grade three. They're eight, they're almost nine, and they feel kind of like bigger kids. I think it's a really great opportunity for kids that age to have more leadership and to feel like they can tell you, what do we know? Let's go out and discover some stuff together. Keep having that conversation about what types of touch do you like? Do you like hugs? And when I say what kind of touch, I ask kids in school, what kind of touch do you like? They fill out an entire board with types of touch. So we're talking about, and it's so sweet, it's you guys. They're talking about the touch that they get from you. Head tickle, arm tickle, butterfly kisses, nose touches, forehead to forehead touches, snuggling with my mom, snuggling with my dad and reading a book, snuggling with Sammy, snuggling with my auntie, watching a movie and eating popcorn, having my hair brushed when my mom finally gets finished detangling my hair. Like, it's really hilarious. Wrestling comes up a lot. So kids really know what they like, and we just need to kind of pay attention to when they're saying no, that we're listening to that. And also that when we're saying no, they're listening to that. So our job, a big part I find for grade three and up, is actually modeling almost more than information. So how are we in our relationships at home? We are probably having moments of sadness, having moments of frustration, having moments of like total frustration, perhaps homeschooling. How are we repairing those moments of frustration with our families? That's teaching our kids about healthy relationships. And I can tell you, I am not an expert at parenting. For a while, I wanted to say I was a parent coach. I purposely am not a parent coach, because I have tons to learn as a parent. I get super frustrated, and I don't think I'm an expert at all when it comes to parenting. I do think that it's important to remember to be kind to yourself. And actually, I feel like one of the biggest lessons that I'm having over the break is, how can I keep myself healthy? Because really, if I'm not healthy and I'm not taking care of myself, I'm not showing my kids how to practice real self-care. I can talk about it forever and ever, and my partner can be really good at it. But if I'm not good at it, they're learning that, oh, some people are good at it and some people aren't. And oh, well, it doesn't really matter. So I've really been doing a lot more exercise and taking care of myself. And what do you know, I'm parenting better. So I would strongly suggest that piece. And it's interesting, because in the curriculum, what do kids learn in grade 4 and 5? Physical, emotional, and social changes that occur during puberty, including those involving sexuality and sexual identity, as well as factors that influence self-identity, including body image and social media. So what we're doing online, how we're posting, how we're talking about our own bodies, how we're, you know, what we're drawn to in social media, that our kids are seeing us drawn to, our kids are learning from that. And sometimes it's hard to see that reflection, because it's like, oh, but I really like Kim Kardashian and I want to follow them, or whatever it is that we all have our like love is blind, you know. But I think it's just important to kind of realize, what are your values? What's important to you? What do you want to teach your kids? If equality is a really important thing, then focus on how you can teach out in the world about equality. See that couple, how they're both holding hands and they lean together and they lean away. What does body language look like? What does healthy body language look like? Who do you think that couple is over there? Do you think they're romantic, or do you think they're not romantic? Why? What makes a good friend, right? Having these conversations about friendship. Physical, emotional, and social changes. Kids really want to learn about what's happening with puberty. I think one of the best ways to talk about puberty is actually to talk about your own experience of puberty. That doesn't mean that you can give them like the most horrifying story, because it might scare them. Like, when I got my period at camp and everyone saw, like, maybe not that one. But for example, when I grew up, I grew tall really quickly and I used to fall all the time. I would roll my ankles all the time. All of my arms started getting way longer than I was used to. And I used to trip like many times on my walk to school in the morning. I always thought how amazing it would be if I had like a cam or a GoPro camera that could have filmed me, because I could have had my own personal fail videos. So like kids want to hear those stories because they want to hear the lightness in getting through it. And they also need to know that they're right on track, that everyone's going through it at the same time, that they're not alone. So how am I doing for time?
5 minutes.
Amazing. Okay. So when it comes to puberty, you might have seen that I've been doing some posts. I've been doing some posts online with a lot of kids come to the Zoom, my Facebook page, and then I do a Zoom session on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Tuesdays is the older kids, so that's kind of like 5, 6, 7. And Tuesdays is the younger kids, both at 1 o'clock. And it's really fun because the kids in the older group are 10, 11, 12. They are so excited to hear about puberty. They want to hear about the physical changes. They want to hear about hair. They want to hear about skin changes. They want to ask their parents, what kind of skin cream do you use? What kind of face wash do you use? Do you use deodorant? A lot of the kids will be like, I'm already using deodorant. They're really curious about these really typical changes that are happening in their body. And what an incredible way for them to learn about the physical changes from their families. And when we talk about it, we normalize it. We make it part of the conversation. And when we notice that we're starting to feel a bit uncomfortable, we can stop talking about it, change the subject, or say, you know, I didn't really get this class. And, you know, sometimes I feel a little nervous talking about this because I just didn't really learn about it when I was a kid. And when it comes down to it, most of us wish that we had heard a little bit more when we were younger, so it wasn't a big surprise what was coming. So finally, I would say, in terms of physical, emotional, and social changes, for the four, fives, and six, they're also working on fluency in terms of their reading. So this is an excellent opportunity to go out and buy a couple of books or borrow some from the library when the library is open, and just, you know, place them around the house. A really cool trick is to actually say, hey, I got you this book. Actually, I got this book, wondering if it would be a good book to get as a present also for fill in the blanks. Let's say your cousin who's the same age or whoever. Can you take a look at it and see if you think it would be a good present? So what you're doing is you're giving your child permission to kind of go through it with a really critical eye, and to also purposely have a conversation with you. They might remember that you're going to give it to the cousin. They might not remember that you're going to give it to a cousin. You can also, all the kids at Waldorf always say, you could also just say, I got you this book because I really care about you and puberty, and I want you to know all the changes. I really like for you to take a look at it. And then let me know what you think. They always say you should always just tell the truth. And I always think that's the most amazing answer ever. So take your time. You've got time. You can also pay attention to those signs of puberty. Some of the first ones are the feet growing bigger. The scent gland inside the armpit starts turning on, and you can start really smelling that BO, which I know you know all about. And then the breast tissue development, some hair. So when you're starting to see that hair and breast development, usually the period or like menstruation is kind of just around the corner, maybe about like 6 months to a year away. I also tell kids about vaginal fluids, because a lot of kids think something's wrong with them. They start noticing that there's a lot of fluid. They're like, what's wrong with me? Am I peeing my pants? I'm like, no, your body's just producing a lot of estrogen. That's exactly what your body's supposed to do. It feels a little embarrassing for them sometimes to be hearing it, but they're so relieved that they're okay. Yeah. And also penis owners, you know, penises are going up and down all the time. I classically tell kids that when they get an erection at school, which is super normal, that all the kids in high school, I always say all the kids in high school, always get a book and just put it in front of them like this, like, no big deal. and then walk like this. And that way no one sees the erection, but you're also just focusing on taking some deep breaths. It comes and it goes, because, you know, if you're a penis owner, you got lots of testosterone and those, you know, erections come and go. So how am I doing?
Right on time.
Amazing. All right. So next we're talking about those bigger kids. So I'm just going to summarize. I talk mostly about 4 or 5s. I'm going to talk about grade 6, 7s. This is the way it's separated on my sheet. So, because I really, again, feel there's a big jump. So with grade 6s and 7s, we're talking about physical, emotional, and social changes, but that's really, I hope by grade 6 and 7 that most of that's covered, and that we're now going to be transferring into starting to talk more about the identity piece, more about the sexual identity, individual identity, gender, values, beliefs, relationships, because this is when we're really getting deep into some friend stuff. BFF forever, like best friend forever. A lot of the, like, you know, kids getting more heavy into sports, if they're, you know, they're specializing some of their skills, right? They're getting away from so many activities and starting to specialize a little bit. And so this is the time when kids really want to practice, what does it mean to be a good friend? What does it mean to be, and be yourself online, but also be safe? So making good choices online, there's a more nuanced conversation here about sending pics. A lot of times it's really common now for kids to say, hey, will you send me a nude, or will you send me a pic? This is just part of the subculture of having a phone at a young age, right? Grade 6, grade 7, grade 8, grade 9. I think it's important as parents to take a step back and think, what would we have done if we had access to an instant picture? For example, if I'm at the grocery store and I'm really hungry and I look down and there's chocolate, my impulse control is really bad. And there's an entire marketing campaign. That's why all of those chocolate bars are sitting there, and chips are, so we can grab them on as our final decision on the way out. So it's the same thing for kids. They don't have impulse control. They do, but they don't have it. It's not refined. And so it's a really unrealistic expectation for us to think that they can handle having a phone by themselves without some kind of guidance or navigation. So I think that as soon as we give our kids a phone, we have to really think, what can I install on the back end that I can help support and coach my young person? Not because I don't trust them. In fact, the exact opposite. I want to build trust, and I want to build connection and communication and values. The same values I have in real life, I want to have online. I want my kids to be able to explore with maybe having their own avatar, a different name. They're probably going to experiment with being mean online. They're probably going to experiment with being silly and weird online and taking risks. That's part of growing up into a teenager, is actually the importance of risk taking. But I want to do that with, it's a different world, right? It's a frontier land that we're, you know, many of us are not familiar with. I'm going to tell you a story. When I was 15, total tech fail, I sent a sexy letter by fax.
That's a dated sentence.
Yeah, it was a fax. And so where would that have gone? Like out of my dad's home office into somebody else's home office. Yeah. So, you know, I think we all need coaching when it comes to tech and how we use it. For example, my kids are learning how to answer the phone properly because they didn't grow up answering the phone. So my kids are learning how to do greetings and say goodbye. So kids that are in grade 6 and 7 need to learn how to communicate back and forth with their friends, asking questions. They need to learn how to text appropriately. They need to learn what spam is when a phone call comes in that they don't know. These are all things I've seen kids see come into their phone. They're like, I don't know whose number that is. And I'm like, oh, that's really normal. You just have to block that number. So rather than like, oh, cyberbullies and it's so scary, I think that we all need to take a big step back and just go, you know, kids are just learning, and tons of kids are making mistakes, which they should be. And so how do we all support each other by staying connected as a community? And for example, there's an organization in the Lower Mainland called Boomerang. Use boomerang.com. I'll also post that after at the end of the thread. And it's three dads that started a company. One of the dad's sons is on the autism spectrum, and he wanted to have some kind of screen control or screen timer. So that's how they got started. But now you can see the YouTube history. You can see incoming. There's artificial intelligence. So if any swear words come in through text, only the swear words, only the text with inappropriate content are flagged. All the other ones aren't. So you're not seeing everything your kid's doing. You're just getting flags for like, hey, send me a naked pic. You would get that text. And guess what? Your kid's not going to send a naked pic because they're like, oh my gosh, I'm so embarrassed. My mom saw that too. And then when I go to my kid, I'm going to say, hey, you don't have to be embarrassed, but let's figure out how we're going to respond to this together. Let's be clever. And no, you don't want to have a picture of your so-and-so online because it doesn't go well. I've not seen it go well yet. I think it goes well for adults. You know, I think some adults have really excellent relationships, but kids aren't adults. They're not ready for that. How are we doing? Still okay? I got to go on to the team. Okay.
Oh, sorry. So, 4 minutes for this one. So I guess you're ahead.
Okay. That's great. Yeah. I'm going to carry on to eights and nines. So in my experience, grade eights and nines are very, very funny. They are pretty darn silly. And I don't want to get too gendered here, but in my experience, those with more testosterone or the boys are really, really bouncy like jelly beans in the school. And they just bounce around. They're pretty darn silly. But they also want to do physical stuff to learn about their body. They're still really interested in hearing what's going on. They need a lot of skill development in managing all that energy. And similarly, people with more estrogen, they tend to be really that kind of energy. And so I think a lot of those activities around what can you do to take care of yourself, self-care, journaling, having a bath, going for a run, doing some physical output. These regulation activities are going to be really, really helpful for self-care into the teen years. And I know the schools are doing a really good job of that. And again, that self-care piece, you doing it yourself, and then, you know, modeling how to take care of yourself with your kids. I've seen a lot of kids around here, like running with their parents or going on bike rides with their parents. And that's such an incredible thing to share with your kids, those kind of getting outside and just regulating your emotions. In grade eight and nine, we start talking about, again, influences of physical, emotional, and social changes on identity and relationships, consequences of bullying, stereotyping, and discrimination. So we start to get into some of those higher level conversations. So you can see how starting way down kindergarten, grade one, grade two, they're building all the names, they're building knowledge of the body. Grade three, grade four, grade five, they're starting to figure out who they are, what kind of friends they like, that some changes are about to happen. How do they like to express themselves? Grade five, grade six, grade seven, more on physical changes, social, emotional. And then grade eight, grade nine, more about, you know, oh, right, there's people outside of me. It's not just me, but now I'm looking out to friends. I'm looking out to community. I think, again, in grade eight and nine is a really important time to start giving more responsibility and trust to our kids, because the more they can do on their own, that develops their self-esteem. That reminds them that they can do a lot of things by themselves. So also pretend, this is when grade nine is also potential short and long-term consequences of healthy decisions, including protection from sexual transmitted infections, healthy sexual decision-making. So this piece about healthy sexual decision-making, there are definitely some grade nines and eights that need this information. And you probably know your kids better than anybody else when it comes to, for example, if somebody is on here and they have older siblings and the younger siblings are older naturally because they've kind of really related to their older siblings. That would be a good time to kind of talk to everybody about it. watching shows together and talking about the characters, talking about the relationships of the characters, watching Queer Eye and talking about how, you know, how so much of your self-esteem is about taking care of yourself and then surrounding yourself with people that lift you up. Those are the kinds of conversations that I think grade eights and nines are really looking for. There are definitely some kids in grade eight and nine that need to talk about condoms. They need to talk about birth control. Those kids, I would definitely say, we're talking about that in grade nine. Grade eight, my experience is a lot of kids are like, hell no, I'm never having sex. And statistically, we also see that a lot of kids are not having sex in grade eight and nine. It's a very small number. So grade 10, I really love the idea in grade 10 of having learned about condoms, having learned about STIs, but now in grade 10, we have these higher level conversations about not just condoms and STIs, but like, how do you have that conversation about, I need you to wear a condom? How do you have that conversation about like, hey, I don't really want to do this tonight, and those negotiations of consent? So we going way back to that kindergarten, when we're wrestling with our kindergarten on the bed and we say no, and they hear us. And when I say no, vice versa, they say no, I hear them, and vice versa, they hear me. We're putting in place the foundations for that grade 11, that's now about to have their first sexual experience or makeout or whatever they're going to do, and feel really good about it because they actually are paying attention to their body. They've got some self-care going on. They're like, oh my gosh, I feel nervous. And they can feel that. That's good. Right. Oh my gosh, I really want to do this because it feels so good. Good. Do it. Right. I mean, pleasure is another piece that we so often forget about mentioning, but pleasure is even in that conversation about touch. When we talk about what types of touch we like, we are talking about what feels good and what doesn't feel good. And when something doesn't feel good, what are some ways that we can negotiate to change that touch? Because those conversations are exactly what's needed for that foundation of a healthy relationship. So, you are not alone. There are tons of ways that we can access resources. There's so many great resources out there now. Options for Sexual Health, of course, is a really excellent resource. I'm doing a ton of teacher training because I really believe teachers want to teach this and have the capacity to. I do a lot of parent training. I know you can do this. I know you have these incredible conversations with your kids because I know your kids. I get to teach them and they are incredible. And they come up with these profound statements, which I know you're teaching them. So thanks for watching tonight. And now we're going to do some questions. So how are we doing? Did we get any questions?
We don't have any yet, and I'm hoping people will ask, but I have a couple that I can put forward.
Go for it.
So I know, I don't have kids, but I see, in sitcoms and all that, and just from parents that I know, the awkward moment when your little one will say certain words in public. Are there any tips for convincing them to not do that? Mm-hmm. Without shaming them, of course.
Mm-hmm. Well, so I have that kid for sure. In fact, this week we're all doing a challenge, and his challenge is to not say poo, pee, bum, penis, diarrhea, anything at the table. And he's actually doing really well. So sometimes it just, if there is a kid that's kind of fixated on wanting to say these things, you're going to have some embarrassing moments. But when you're away from people to kind of, especially sometimes if we're in a car or if we're like sitting for the bus, having a moment to just say, hey, you know, I think you probably noticed how everyone had that big reaction back there when you shouted penis in the grocery lineup. And the reason is a lot of people don't say that word out loud. It's not a bad word. It's actually a perfect word for the body part that it belongs to. But, I often say, and some people don't relate to this, but I say the rule in our family is that we can talk about that anytime in our home, when we're walking on the street together. But we try to avoid having those conversations in public places, mostly because it can be surprising for other people if they hear a conversation. So it's a way of kind of like reminding them of that public and private division.
Yeah, that's a really good way to put it. Please feel free to ask questions if you have any.
Yeah, this is your moment. Any questions?
Do you have any tips? So say like you move from somewhere where the school curriculum didn't have the same kind of building block structure. Do you have any tips for parents who need to sort of play catch up with kids that haven't been taught the base knowledge, like the base vocabulary or the sort of base level of consent? Do you have any kind of suggestions for that?
That's a really good question. I mean, it really depends as a parent how much time you have, but I would say books are an excellent resource for that. In fact, one book, particularly by an author named Roby Harris, is excellent. She has an incredible range of books, but one book, it's called Amazing You. And I can post that again too. I have to be reminded actually what I said I was going to post before because I already forget.
I have the email here. I can actually post it now.
Okay, amazing. The email, but also I said I was going to post something, but I forgot. Oh, Boomerang. Use Boomerang. So I'm going to post Use Boomerang, which is the parent control. And then also I just said Amazing You. Or I think it's called It's So Amazing. Anyway, I'll post the book. Why I love that book is in one book, it's for kids ages 4 and up, but you could have that book until you're like 13 years old and still learn information from it. So it's really cartoon based. A lot of the drawings are really kind of animated, but also really quite detailed. It talks about mammals. It talks about the sperm and the egg. It talks about the amazing egg race, which is for periods or menstruation. It talks about ejaculation and nocturnal emissions. So, but it talks about it in a really playful way that's really accessible to young kids. So young kids would just see the pictures, whereas the older kids that can read would be reading the words. And then grade 4, that's when we're getting comprehension. And so I would say one or two good books and you'd be caught up in time. Yeah, for sure.
Books are super helpful.
Good.
I guess on that note too, we have a teen booklet that we've developed with Modern Language. I'm posting the link now.
So great. It's such a great book.
So that's available there as a free resource. And it covers like a wide breadth of knowledge in a very open and empowering way without being gendered and all that good stuff. Okay, I have one more question.
Okay, great. that, if we don't get questions, which is no big deal, I have some typical questions that I can go through.
Okay. Do you have any tips for, say you have a really shy kid, do you have any tips for building trust so that you can have these conversations with them openly without, you know, the level of stress that comes with that kind of anxiety?
That's a great question. I would say that because people that, you know, I think that family members are really good at reading their own kids, and it might be also like family friends that are good at reading kids too. For example, I have a godson who I'm starting to get to know more and more, and reading his body language helps me. He's more shy than my kids. And of course I'm like, not his mom. So I like to read his body language and to see how he's doing. And if he kind of gives me, he changes the subject or he goes to something else, just to go with it, not to push a topic. I would also say that so much of the learning is the way that two people interact with their bodies. So, you know, if a kid is kind of like holding your hand and snuggling up tight, finding storybooks. So it's not asking questions directly, but it's using a really sweet and beautiful story to learn the lesson. Because a lot of people say, well, we need to wait for our kids to ask the questions. And honestly, some kids aren't going to ask. They just aren't. And other kids are going to ask like, whoa, stuff that you're just like, what? Like, how did you even come up with that? But so we need to kind of, I think, take our cues from our kids and then also just remember the more we talk about things that are important to our family, kids pick up on it. They know what's important to their family. They tell me all the time, especially actually kids with developmental delays. They're really clear on what their family believes.
Thank you. We have one. How can parents manage their own anxiety or sense of shame when it comes to having this conversation? Which is a great question.
That's a great question. So sexuality is such a tricky topic because, of course, it's so laden with shame. It can be, I should say. And also, of course, I want to say Bill Staten is his name. He's kind of a famous sexual health educator, and he talks about every time we talk about sexuality, there's three things that come up. Trauma, secrecy, and ignorance. And I would say with that trauma, you know, shame is part of all three of those, really. I feel ashamed to talk about it. I feel ashamed that I don't know. I feel ashamed that this happened, right? So I think that being really gentle with yourself and thinking about what are your core beliefs, what's ultimately important to you that your kids learn about, and know that you're not alone. There's a lot of support out there to help you work through any of your discomfort in terms of if you have trauma that you're working through, or you have something in the past that's happened that's really kind of made you have a really strong belief about something in a certain way that's kind of a barrier to talk about it, for you to do some of that work. Also to ask for support if you have a partner, you know, that you're not alone, that, you know, you probably have friends in your community that would be willing to, that might be slightly better at talking to you. You might be like the nutrition one and they might be like the sex ed one, you know? I think that not everyone has to talk about sexuality. And I think it's not for everybody to teach it. I know when I go into schools, a lot of teachers are like, no, this is not for me. And I'm like, well, you know what? I would have a really hard time teaching algebra. So that's not really for me. And so I think it's actually an unrealistic expectation that everyone's supposed to be so good at talking about sexuality. So yeah, I would say be easy on yourself, and remember that you may not have had this class as a kid. In fact, very likely you didn't, and very likely your parents may not have taught you anything. And so you're learning something that's brand new, and to use books, to use videos, practice a neutral face, and practice not reacting. And if you don't know the answer to something, I always refer to Options for Sexual Health has a 1-800 number or a chat. So you can actually, if your kids ask you a question, you can type that question in and say, how would you answer this? And they will type an answer within 24 hours back to you. So there's nothing wrong to say to kids too, that's a really good question. I don't know how to answer it right now, but I'm going to get back to you. And then do get back to them with the answer at some point.
Thank you. That's very good. We haven't had any more come in. We're at 9:12. So if you had any.
Okay. So I would say I just want to give everybody an idea of how cute and sweet some of the questions are that kids ask. So I think what I'm going to do is pull out a giant box of questions that I have that I've been collecting for years and actually just read some of them and answer them just off the cuff. So I'm going to be right back. Okay. So you wouldn't believe it, but this box is full of anonymous questions. And I should get rid of them, but I want to keep them for some strange reason. So let's go. So let's go to some of the kid questions. These are some elementary. Can nudes actually turn guys on? That's an elementary question. I would say that yes, they can, that people tend to be aroused by the human form. And we can see examples of that in beautiful art over the centuries. And there's nothing wrong with being aroused by a human form. However, the challenge with us is having this medium that's so public. So something that was meant to be private is shared almost every single time to people that you probably don't want to see it. How do girls masturbate? This is a great question from also an elementary student. So I would answer that by saying everybody's body's different, but usually when we're talking about a girl that would masturbate or somebody with a vulva, most of the sensation is on the clitoris or around the clitoris and then into the root, but also around the sides of the labia are also very sensitive. So they would probably rub that part of the body. They could do that with their hand. They might do that with water. And it would be something they would do in private. And it's also a really normal and typical thing for young people to do. Some little kids will rub that part of their body because it feels really good. And then some kids will find that part later on. And some kids won't find that part till much later, but nothing bad would happen to you. I also want you to know it's actually a really excellent way to figure out what feels good in your body. So, but it is private. We don't really talk about it at school. At what age do you think you should have sex? Now, this is a really interesting question. So when I talk about kids and their family values or kind of like talking about values at home, this question is interesting because they're asking permission. They're saying to me, when do you think I should have sex? And I always say, when do you think you should have sex? Because that's something that you would need to know. Everybody has a different idea in their mind. In some families, they need to wait till they're in their late teens, 20s, 30s. Some people never get married. Some people have to wait to have sex until, or to have sex after marriage. Every family is different. So it would be really good for you to find out by either kind of listening and or having conversations with your families as you get older to figure out what's the right time. The other thing that I want to talk about here is healthy sexual decision making, because this is a question about when do you think you should have sex? And so we need to talk about what are the feelings that a person might have in order to feel comfortable to be intimate with another person. And so I always just, to make it really literal, I talk about pretending that we have traffic lights. So if we have a traffic light in our mind, that traffic light has to do with our intellect. Do we feel connected to this person? Do we feel like they understand us, that they care for us, that we enjoy spending time with them? In our heart, when we're with that person, are we drawn to them? Are they drawn to us? Do we feel comfortable with them? Do we feel safe with them? Do you feel safe being alone with them? Do they feel safe being alone with me? And do I feel safe being naked with them? When I ask kids that, they're like, what? You have to be naked? I'm like, yeah, usually people have sex when they're naked. I don't know. Maybe not all the time. But and then finally, I talk about the gut feeling, like that feeling of survival. Like, do you feel like you could, does it feel right? Or are you like, So we have red, yellow, green. So red is like, no. Red, yellow, green. Red, yellow, green. So if it's a red in your mind, I can't do this. It doesn't match up with my belief systems. If it's a red anywhere, it's a no. If it's a green light, green light, green light, that's a go. If it's a yellow light, green light, it's still a no. But maybe it's a yes. Maybe somebody is willing to take that risk with the yellow. Like, I'm not sure, but I think I'm going to do it. I tell kids that sometimes when what we want doesn't line up with how we feel, then we have regrets. But that's also just part of being human, right? So, okay. Now, any other questions, people? Anybody? You can see we can answer a whole bunch of different ones here. I do take it back. These are high school questions based on what I'm seeing now. Okay, this is grade 7 though. Some of them are just comments. I like that you were open with us. I liked how you told us the stories.
Well, that's a big part of it too, right? Is the vulnerability, the honesty. I think it's very appreciated because it builds trust both ways.
Big time, big time. And just, yeah, like being, you know, this person said, what's your son's name? Okay, but this is grade 7 and they said, when is an appropriate age to have sex? So, you know, the thing that's really interesting is kids have a lot of questions about sex way before they're thinking about doing it themselves. And so I think sometimes as parents, it might be alarming to go, what, kids are asking about sex? I mean, maybe not. Maybe there's a bunch of parents that are like, it's no big deal. But they're curious, right? They're really curious about this topic because when you think of our society, we are surrounded by like enormous amounts of sexual expression, right? Sexual expression, like, you know, even if we disregard pornography, which is a huge amount of the sexual expression online, if you look at Instagram, it's like all these kind of pictures about being beautiful and being beautiful as part of being a woman, and like all of this gender-based stuff and pressures. And so much of it has to be about being sexy and hot. And same for all people. All people are feeling that, right? Whether you feel invisible, whether you feel visible, whether you feel, everybody's feeling this kind of need to be desirable. And it's interesting to me because there's so much more to healthy relationship and attraction than being desirable. And desire is so different for everybody. So I think that kids really want to talk a little bit about that. They want to talk about, like, you know, how did you meet, how did you meet Dad? Or how did you meet Sam? How did you meet Jenny? When, you know, how did you know that you were in love? Those kinds of conversations in grade 7, grade 8, grade 9, grade 10, all the way through, are so meaningful, because as the brain develops, they're going to pick up little pieces all the way along. So hug your kids, hold them close, teach them what love is, and they will have love in their life. Yeah. So it's 9:20. There are 10 people watching. I'm going to give you guys another chance to ask a question. If you do have a question, honestly, anything, don't be afraid. I tell you very truthfully, I have been asked everything under the sun. You wouldn't believe. Imagine a box that big of questions. There's some pretty weird ones. So for example, here's one, grade 7. When do guys get erect? Great question. Well, that when there's a heightened testosterone in the body, when they're aroused, and not always when they're aroused, though. A lot of the time it's just a big flow of testosterone, and super normal. Guys would have, in the middle of the night, penis owners would have 5 to 6 erections throughout the evening and not wake up for any of them. They would just be, that's just waves of testosterone coming through their body. So, wow, this is a long one here. So any questions, anything coming in? No? Oh, this one, you guys, I would love to hear. I wish I could hear families respond to this.
It's the only thing with doing it online.
That's okay. I know. I mean, this one is so sweet. And I have had a couple of young girls come up to me and say, what do you do if you feel really uncomfortable telling your parents if you had your period? So let's see. The last girl that came up to me and said, I cannot tell my mom. I said, first of all, I wanted to validate. So we follow a little bit of a formula. So the first thing you want to do is validate their comment and say, that makes sense, right? It makes sense that you might feel nervous to tell them. And then maybe you talk a little bit about, like, what are the reasons that you feel nervous? Like, what are the things that, and of course you'd also want to not be like in the hallway of the school, but probably in a private place or semi-private so that you're away from people. But not necessarily alone with the child. And then this person said, you know, I'm nervous because, like, for sure she doesn't want me to tell her. So it, from what I could tell from the young person, it sounded like there really had not been any conversations about bodies, that it was just not really, the message was, we haven't talked about it, so we're not going to talk about it, and you shouldn't talk about it, right? But I know that the mom has her period, and that also, no matter what, she knows she has 3 daughters, they're all going to get their periods, and she's the first one. And so I said, you know, as much as you're afraid to talk about this with your mom, she's expecting that you're going to get your period. And so she's also probably expecting that you will talk to her about it. And even if she hasn't talked to you about it yet, she might be waiting for you to say, you know. And also I talked about, she probably didn't have, her mom probably didn't have this class, and maybe she got her period and was just as scared to tell her mom. But the thing is that every single person in the world with a uterus gets their period. And so we try to really normalize that piece. And by the end, I said, do you think you'd feel comfortable to talk to your mom? And she said, I think so. Okay, I think I can do it. And I was so happy because I, of course, that mom wants to hear from her daughter, right? Even if we're afraid, even if we have shame, you know, we still want to be there for our family to support them. And so, you just got to work through that discomfort. And I guess the other piece is being uncomfortable is part of being human. You know, we just can't be comfortable all the time, as much as we'd like to be.
We had another question come in. What should you do if you suspect your kid has an STI?
Oh, good question. If you suspect that your kid has an STI, I would, I'm so curious about how they suspect that they have one, but I would probably just be really honest and gentle and say, hey, you know, we haven't really talked about this before. Maybe we have talked about this before, but I was just wondering if you have, you know, I know that you were intimate with so-and-so, and I just wanted to make sure that you're getting tested regularly, because it's really important to know there's a lot of STIs that don't have some signs and symptoms. And so I'm just a little nervous that maybe if you're not getting tested, you could have an infection, and that way it would be not good in your body. It would be hurting your body. For example, chlamydia is a super common STI that so many kids get, ages, you know, 14 to 24, are very high rates, and they don't have any symptoms. How are they supposed to know they have it if nothing is different? I mean, I'm wondering if this mom has like smelt something different, or you know, or like if this parent has kind of witnessed something like that. So I would probably just have a frank conversation, maybe get some ice cream and like set up a movie and just try to be looking forward instead of maybe looking at them. Sometimes face to face can be really uncomfortable, and it's nicer to be looking out. Car rides, long car rides are a good time to talk about how you lock them in your car and they can't get out. So that, I good luck though, that's awesome that you're paying attention to that. So yeah.
All right, we've got a few minutes left. Do you want to tell people where they can find you if they have any questions? Sure. You have an Askable Adult series, right?
Yes, that's right. So I do teach what's called an Askable Adult, and I have three different offerings for the Askable Adult workshop, which are really fun. It's 2 hours long. We go kind of a lot more into building comfort to talk about sexuality and health. And right now I don't have any set up out there in the world, but I would be happy to kind of run one online if there was interest. So if you are interested in finding out more about that, you can check out my website. I have all of the information there at shift-education.com. The other thing is you can just shoot me an email or a text and let me know. I'm wondering if actually you should take my phone number out of the Facebook page.
Did already.
I'm going to get so much spam. But you can contact me through my website, or you can just contact me at jessica@shift-education.com. And I would love to hear from you. You can message me on Facebook. There's a million ways to get a hold of me. So if you reach out and you want to do an Askable Adult, I'm all over it. Basically the three iterations of it. One is the babies, bodies, and boundaries. That's for basically little people all the way to age six, parents of those people. How can we start on a good foundation? The next one is school-aged kids, and the last one is teenagers, how to talk to teenagers. And I also have a diverse ability group. So I have one where I teach to parents of diverse learners, or foster parents of diverse learners. And that one's really cool too, because it's very much, it's catered to diverse learners and kind of going through things little by little, and really focusing on the questions. So.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for partnering in so many meaningful ways. I'm excited for life to maybe get back on track at some point, so we can do the circuit, the sex ed circuit again. And thank you so much for setting this up and for hosting and helping me with my time management.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you for watching. Bye.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everybody, and we'll hopefully see you soon.
Sounds good. Bye. Okay.